Okay, again, welcome. So Pedro, now I have to say his name, Pedro Feal. So he studied applied mathematics and genome rearrangement at the University of Campinas in Brazil. And after that, he worked as a postdoc in the bioinformatics at Bielefeld University in Germany. And he has now joined the labs at SFU. He's working with Leonid, Cedric, and Will on computational epidemiology, where he is a postdoctoral fellow. And please help me welcome Pedro, please.
Thanks a lot for the introduction. Hi, everyone. My name is Pedro. As you know, I'm going to talk about here reconstruction of ancestral gene orders. So this was work mostly done at Bielefeld while I was a postdoc there. So let me start talking about what are genomes. So there are many definitions of genomes depending on what we work with. So let me start talking what I think when I'm working with a genome. So for me, a genome is a series of DNA blocks, like this bottom one here. And these blocks usually are called genes, even though they might not be genes, just contiguous DNA pieces. So I have one genome here with 11 blocks. They are usually labeled with integers from 1 to 11. And I have a different genome on the top where it also has the same 11 blocks, but they are in different parts of the genome. They have been rearranged through evolution. And it also happens that some of these genes have reverse orientation with respect to the other genome, and we usually represent this with a negative sign. So this gene, this green gene here, is in opposite orientation in the DNA strand in relation to the other one. So here we are interested in a evolutionary sense to know what happened during evolution, that these two genomes have very similar genes, but in a very different position and orientation. And by the way, this is not a made-up example. This is actually coming from the X chromosome of both mouse and human, where some researchers identified these 11 blocks as being very similar in terms of DNA sequence, but in completely different areas of the genome. So one way to look at these differences is to define some kind of rearrangement events. And you can think of some kind of edit distance that you apply these operations to one genome, and you're interested to know how far is the other genome in terms of this edit distance. And one very famous one is the reversal distance, because it's a very, it's probably one of the most common types of rearrangement operations happening in genomes. So you can take a block of these contiguous genes here and just reverse it. So all the order of these genes and also the orientation, which means the signs of the genes, have been reversed. And using something like this, you can see, it was shown that in 7 steps is the minimum way that you can go from one genome to the other. And this defines what we call a rearrangement distance, because this is the minimum number of steps that you use this edit distance to go from one genome to the other. And the entire number of steps is called a rearrangement scenario. So this is one particular example. There are many, but we know that you cannot do in less than 7 steps. So this is the distance between these two genomes. So when we talk about genome rearrangement problems, we usually talk about these problems of the distance, which is the minimum number of rearrangements you need to get to go from genome A to B. You also talk about scenarios, which is a very related problem, which rearrangement, not only the number, like 7 reversals, but specifically which rearrangements, and there might be many. And this problem is also commonly called sorting, because if you think about it, you're kind of sorting one genome in relation to the other, all the rearrangement blocks back to the sorted orientation. We also think about phylogeny. So if you have more than 2 genomes, several genomes, how can you explain, usually in a phylogenetic tree, how did the rearrangement evolution happen between this group of genomes? And also ancestral reconstruction, which is my focus today, which is trying to find out how do the ancestors, or how did the ancestors look like in terms of this gene orders, where were the rearranged genes during evolution. So here I took the titles of many rearrangement papers that I have accumulated along the years and did this kind of nice word cloud to show you that, well, the focus is usually the genome on the center, and it's nice that the word ancestral was right close to genome, because this lots of times is the focus, trying to find ancestral genomes. But I also painted in orange the problems that you usually try to solve. So you see that the distance problem, the sorting problem, as I mentioned, are very common. And also we are interested in reconstruction and phylogeny. But also, I also painted in green the different types of rearrangement models or distances that have been defined, because I showed you reversal distance, but there are many models and distances that you could define. And here you could use translocation, which is a different type of distance, or breakpoint distance, and many others. So in a nutshell, many of the research in genome rearrangements has been assuming a green type of distance from this list and trying to solve one type of orange problem from this list, sort of. So now I'm going to focus on ancestral reconstruction, the last item on that list, which I've been working more recently. And the usual setup is that we have, as input, a tree, a phylogenetic tree, with a number of extant genomes at the leaves. So in this example, A, B, C, and D, these are known genomes in that encoding that I showed you, with a bunch of genes and integers. And what I want to find out is what are the ancestral genomes, so the labeled M1, M2, and M3 on this tree. So go back in the evolutionary history and try to figure out who are those guys. So it's nice to divide methods for this kind of problem in two broad areas, which are the distance-based methods and homology-based methods. Distance-based methods are just using that distance definition that I briefly showed at the beginning. And if you think about that, given that I have this example here, I could just put any set of genomes that I put as the internal nodes here, immediately is going to give me some number of events in each branch of the tree, depending on the rearrangement distance that I define. For instance, I could use reversals, and then the number on each branch gives me the number of reversals between these genomes. And which is quite common to do is try to minimize, what is common to do is to minimize the number of events on this tree as a parsimonious way of finding the best genomes according to this criteria. So in this setting, we're trying to find ancestral genomes that minimize the number of events on this tree, rearrangement events. This is usually very hard to do, as NP-hard for most of the nice distances, but still there is lots of work on this direction. Another way of thinking about this problem is avoid rearrangements completely and just try to think about conserved homolog pieces on this genome. So I could look at this 3 and 4 here on this genome on the left and see that this block is conserved on the other genome here. So most likely the common ancestor of the two should have this conserved block, because there's no signs of any rearrangement going on here. So I could code these genomes in 0-1 binary vectors saying this adjacency is present, 1, or not present, 0, so, and then I have a character-based type of phylogeny. There are many methods to do that. Another thing I can do is define some kind of adjacency weights. So adjacencies are the pairs of common genes, and I can assign values from 0 to 1, saying how confident I am that these adjacencies are present on the common ancestor. So 3 and 4, I put 0.9 because I think they are very likely, but other adjacencies might have less than that. What I did kind of combines both ideas, and is the main point is the idea of intermediate genomes, where if we think about evolution, let's take A and B here, and think about of the pairwise comparison, like the very first slide, when I was going from A to B, in terms of reversals, let's say, you know, in a sense, it's like when I apply some reversals to A, I'm going back in evolution, and I continue going to B. So in some point between the path from A to B, I might hit the common ancestor of the two. So the basic idea is very simple. I just have to find all ways from going to A to B and try to see if all of these genomes in between, the intermediate genomes as I call them, are good ancestors. Of course, there's no way to enumerate this because this is exponential, but this is the basic idea. I want to do ancestor reconstruction where the internal nodes of all the in the tree are intermediate genomes of the children. So I'm not going to show any technical details here, but the advantages of this approach is that these intermediate genomes are very, very easy to characterize in combinatoric terms. So they are fast to know if a particular genome is or is not an intermediate genome between any two. This greatly reduces the search space, which is a big issue in this kind of exponential methods. And this is also very easy to combine with the homology approach that I mentioned, that when you have some kind of adjacency weights. I might show, no, I won't. So I'm going to jump directly to the results part without showing any details of this method, just this basic idea that I'm looking for intermediate genomes and combining with adjacency weights. So I'm comparing here three methods, which is Ringo, the one that I'm proposing. This was published last year. So Ringo is ancestral reconstruction with intermediate genomes, based on this intermediate genomes idea. There's MGR2, which is a completely combinatorics distance-based method. And there's MLGO, which is a maximum likelihood method that first has a nice scheme to transform genomes into binary vectors, 0-1 vectors, and then uses some kind of maximum likelihood phylogeny estimation based on RaxML. So the nice thing about these three models is that now we not only model rearrangements, but we also have insertion and deletions of genes, which not all methods out there can solve. Makes the problem a bit more harder when we have not only rearrangements, but also content changing operations like the deletions and insertions. So here I'm showing just a graph of the quality results, which was based on some simulations that we did. So we simulated a bunch of trees and rearrangement evolution and so on, and we ran all methods to see how good they are. So in from left to right, you have very few number of rearrangements to lots of rearrangements, which usually makes the problem harder. So at the very left, you have lots of signal. Everything is easy. Most methods perform very similarly. But as you go to the right, things start to get more difficult. I just zoom in on the very right part, because I was not sure how big the screen is going to be here. But so if you look here, the main point is that MGRA starts to be not so good, because when the distances are very large, combinatoric methods really suffer. And in many instances, even though Ringo does not have, so this is the darker part shows the number of true positives, how many things you got right, and the lighter part, the false positives, how many things you got wrong. So Ringo usually has a very good rate of true positives. Sometimes it's not the best one, but it really has a small rate of false positives. So it really does not make so much mistakes. And the farther to the right you go, the better you see this pattern. Anyway, and the other really, really great point of this algorithm is that because of this space reduction technique, it's really, really fast. So if you compare Ringo, it usually takes between 3 seconds and 7 seconds in any data set. MLGO around 1 minute. And MGRA, this is where you really see that the combinatorics methods suffer with increased complexity, can take anywhere from 7 seconds to up to 2 hours. So Ringo is very fast and usually very accurate as well. Unfortunately, I don't have any results on real data, but I'm working on it. I don't have anything to show right now, but on simulations, it's working really, really, really well. So the current challenges for me, in particular on this project, are how to include duplicated genes, because in general, in genome rearrangements, the really difficult part starts to appear when you have genes that have more than one copy. Even when you have only two genomes, this suddenly becomes very hard to compare. And also to try to include some statistical models in terms of not only finding the minimum distance between genomes, but the most likely distance. So this is a big step from parsimony methods that are looking only for minimizing distance to some more robust statistical estimation of the distance. So I'd like to thank a couple of guys here that helped me during this project. One is Eloy. He is from Brazil, from UFMS. He was a postdoc with us in Germany for 1 year. He's a co-author in this Ringo paper. And also Jens Steuer, which is the group leader back in Bielefeld, where I was a postdoc for about 4 years. With that, thanks for your attention. Any questions? Before.
All
right.
Would we round up here?
Yes.
Does anyone?
Okay. You mean how do we get from real genomes to this bunch of numbers? Good point, and I don't do that. Actually, it's quite common in this field that you start with this idea that genomes are already this bunch of numbers of genes that belong to the same family or are homologous. And you start from there and you develop lots of methods, such as Ringo and others. So to go from real DNA and genomes to this kind of number permutation or genome formulation, there's an almost entire different field that deals with that problem. And it's not so easy. So sometimes if you have, I mean, when you have lots of duplications and this kind of things, it's not easy to define who are the genes, homologous genes or genes on the same family. So this is usually done in an automated way based on BLAST or some kind of similarity measure, where anything above a certain threshold of similarity is considered to be the same family or the same gene, meaning the same number in two genomes. But it might lead to small errors. So in some cases, it's possible to have data sets that have been really curated, where you can say, okay, this number one really corresponds to the other number one and the other genome. This is, but most of the cases, we only have automated tools to do that. So in this particular example, we did simulations. And so we start with some common ancestor, generate a random phylogenetic tree and just simulate evolution with rearrangement events and deletions and insertions. So in this particular case, you know the ground, the truth, which genome is the correct ancestor, and then we run the methods and see how close the methods can estimate the ancestors that we know from the simulations. But when you're dealing with real data, then you have no way to know what is the truth. So each method is going to tell a different story a bit, and it's a matter of knowing how to combine this information to come up with some kind of hypothesis on the data. Okay. Well, the fact that there are ancestors means that they are extinct, so you cannot find them. But if I understood your question correctly, there's some interesting work that you can analyze fossils, and you can take, for instance, bacteria that from that, or even from people who died from black, what is the name in English? Black, black, the plague, like, so you can extract DNA from and kind of reconstruct what would be the ancestor, the real ancestor of ancient bacteria from that people from 100 years ago or something like this. So in this sense, you could use real ancestors. But usually what we have is only, in a general sense, the extant genomes, the current ones. And then we're trying to infer who, how the ancestral genomes that do not exist anymore, how did they look like. Okay. Yep. No, I didn't. But yeah, that's a good idea. Maybe we're all getting wrong parts at the same. We're making the same mistakes, so to say. No, I haven't. But it's a good idea. I'll try that. Thanks. Okay. Thank you.